So remember last class we started talking about memory management. So remember we started with sort of the very simple case of first just one program running at a time, one process running at a time. Remember that's unit programming. And then we moved to the idea of, you know, static and dynamic relocation, which, you know, the idea there is that we are, you know, doing contiguous allocation where we are, you know, sticking our processes in various fixed contiguous blocks of memory. And remember, you know, the essentially main problems we have here are how to place things in memory and then how to do the translation between, you know, virtual and physical addresses. So we started talking about that. So remember, one of the big problems we had with static and dynamic relocation was this idea of fragmentation. So remember, the idea was that as you are allocating process, you know, as you're starting and ending processes, you're ending up with these gaps in memory that are maybe too small to fit, you know, another contiguous process in. And so that's, you know, that's the idea of at least that's external fragmentation. So then, remember, we introduced the idea of paging largely as a way to, you know, get rid of external fragmentation. So before we move on, I wanted to sort of recap what we talked about, just the basic idea of paging. So remember, the idea in paging is that, remember, we have the 90-10 rule. So remember, the 90-10 rule is basically saying that on average, you know, just sort of as a general guideline, a process is typically only using, you know, maybe the same 10% of its memory space 90% of the time. So what that means is that, you know, we don't need to actually, you know, have everything all at once. So we're going to use the idea of paging to take memory that the process has, and rather than allocating it as a contiguous chunk, we're going to split up its memory into fixed size pages. And then we're going to allocate those to frames, and then we can actually manage the pages. So remember, we had this picture of what paging looks like, where we have, again, so this is logical memory, right? So these are virtual addresses outputted by the compiler, and those are still, you know, starting from zero, going up sequentially, right? Because from the view of the program, it's just the same, you know, it looks to the program as if it has all the memory available just starting from zero. But then what the OS is actually doing is we've taken the memory of the process and split it into fixed-size pages and then mapped those pages from logical memory into physical memory. So we have, you know, physical memory is some fixed number of frames, right? And so a frame is the same size as a page. And so pages are being mapped onto frames, and these are giving the actual physical addresses. And so these do not have to be contiguous, right? So the pages could actually be scattered all over physical memory. The process doesn't need to know anything about that because it's still working with, you know, the virtual addresses, which are just starting from zero. And this essentially addresses the problem of external fragmentation, right? Because since everything is allocated as pages, they're all fixed size, there can never be any external fragmentation, right? Because you can always fit in a page, you know, so since the frames are arranged back to back, right? That makes sense why there's no, everyone understand why there's no external fragmentation going on here? Okay. So this is what we already talked about. So we're translating virtual to physical. And so remember, the way we're going to actually do this is by introducing the idea of a page table, right? Because since these pages in virtual memory, logical memory, are mapped to somewhere, some frame in physical memory, we actually need to be able to do that lookup. So to do that, we're going to have this page table. And so a virtual address is now going to include a page number and an offset into that page, right? So the virtual address will tell us some page. So, you know, say it says page 3. So we're going to go to the page table, and the page table is going to tell us that's basically just a lookup table from a page number to a frame number, right? So this might say, you know, page 3 is stored in frame 20, for example. You know, that could be an arbitrary value. Because again, we're not imposing, you know, the pages themselves could be stored anywhere in physical memory. So they could be scattered all over the place. We have this page table that tells us where a specific page is actually located in physical memory. So when we're doing a lookup, when we're translating a virtual address to a physical address, we have the page number, we go to the page table, we look up the frame number, and then we have an offset into that frame. So then the offset tells us, you know, if it's offset 20, then we go to, you know, whatever the frame is, you know, frame 5, and go offset 20 into frame 5, and that gives us the actual physical address that we're looking for, right? That's the actual part in physical memory that has the data that we're looking for, right? So every virtual address now is encoding both a page number and an offset into that page, and that's how we get the physical address. So let's remember we walked through this example last time, but just to quickly recap. So how is it, again, that if we're actually doing this translation and we're giving some, you know, virtual address, how is it that we are actually pulling out the page number, say? Yeah. Right, so remember we talked about the way that we can actually do this in hardware is that we have some, you know, address bits. So maybe we have an 8-bit virtual address. And so what we're going to do is we're going to say some bits of those, the first couple of bits, are going to encode the page number, and the last couple of bits are going to encode the offset into the page. Right? So if I have, you know, virtual address, say, you know, let's say I have a 4-bit virtual address, you know, 4 bits. And let's say, you know, the first 2 bits are the page number and the last 2 bits are the offset. So let's say, you know, I have virtual address 1101, which is, what is that, 12? Mm-hmm. So, you know, if I have this, then what is the page number? So, if, you know, if the first 2 bits are the page number and the last 2 bits are the offset, so this is the page number, this is the offset, so what's the page number here? 3, right? So this is the page number, that's 3, and that's the offset, which is just 1, right? But so remember what we're actually doing here is, remember when we're getting the page number, all we're basically doing is we are dividing by the size of the page. So remember we had this example where let's say we have a 256 byte memory size, right? So we have 256 bytes of physical memory and a page size of 16 bytes. So first of all, if we have 256 bytes of memory and a page is 16 bytes, so how big is the page table going to be? How many entries are in the page table? So that's just 16, right? Because we have 256 memory bytes, and we have 16 bytes to a page. So the page table that's going to cover that whole address space is 16 entries, right? 16 times 16. So now if we want to be able to, you know, address every byte individually, so we have, remember, we have 256 bytes of memory. And we want to be able to individually address every byte. So how many bits do we need for an address? In order to be able to address 256 bytes, how many bits do we need? 8, right? Because 8 bits, 2 to the 8th, gives us 256 bytes. So with 8 bits, we can make a unique address for every single one of our 256 byte addresses. So now remember, we want to take this and encode both the page number and the offset into that page. Right? So we have 16 pages. Right? That's, we just calculated. We have 16 pages here. So how many bits do we need to encode the page number? 4. Right, we have 16 pages, so we need 4 bits, 2 to the 4th, to encode the page number. And then how many bits do we need for the offset? 4, right? Because, first of all, we have, you know, it's an 8-bit address to begin with, so clearly we have, if we have 4 for the page, we also have 4 for the offset. But remember, then, the size of the page is 16 bytes, so clearly, in order to index an offset into a 16-byte page, you need 4 bits for that as well, right? So we have 4 bits that tells us which of the 16 page table entries we're looking at, and then four bits that tells us what the offset is into that specific page. Yep.
So I'm noticing that in the examples that you're giving, it's basically split 50-50. Would that be the most common case that we've ever get?
Not necessarily. We'll actually look at another example in just a second where that's not the case.
Okay.
Other questions? If this is unclear, this is definitely the time to ask, because this is the kind of thing that you should be able to do for, you know, an exam, for example. Okay, so now let's just, you know, we did this again last time, but just to recap, let's say we have, you know, virtual address 24, and we want to do the, you know, virtual to physical translation. So remember, what is the operation that we can do to actually get the page number out of the virtual address? Yeah. Right, so all you need to do is divide by what? Right, you need to just divide by the page, you divide by the page size. Right, so the page size is what? 16, right? So to get the page number, you just divide by the page size. So 24 divided by 16 is what? These are integers, of course, so just 1, right? So the page number is 1, 24 over 16. And then to get the offset into that page, what do you need to do? What was the operation we talked about that can give you the offset? What? Right, you just mod the page size, right? Because you're dividing by the page size, and that gives you the page number, and then you just mod by the page size to get the index, the offset. So 24 mod 16 is what? 8, right? Yep, so the page is 1, 24 over 16. The offset is 8. 24 mod 16 is 8. And then to actually get the physical address, we then would need to go to the page table. So if the page is 1, then what is the frame we're looking at? So we have a little toy page table up here. So if the page number is 1, then... Right, so we just look that up in the table. We have page 1 corresponds to frame 6. So that's where page 1 is stored, in frame 6. So we just go to frame 6, and we have an offset 8 into that, right? Because frame 6 is a 16-byte piece of memory, and so we just offset 8 into that, and that gives us the byte that we're addressing. Yeah. How do you decide what the frame numbers are? Oh, you mean how do you decide how to do this page table mapping?
Yeah.
That's a question that's actually better to defer until next class, because we're going to be talking about actually how the OS ends up putting things into physical memory. I mean, for the moment, we can basically just assume that, you know, the OS gets a page and looks for some open frame in memory and just sticks it in. It sort of doesn't really matter where exactly it is. Right, because right now we're basically assuming that every page is actually in memory somewhere. Next class we're going to talk about the case where that's not actually true. Other questions on this? So remember, we're doing this division to get the page number and the mod to get the offset. But remember, when we're talking about you know, the binary arithmetic of this, because remember we talked about that in practice, we have, you know, the top bits are encoding the page, the bottom bits are encoding the offset. Remember, if we make the page size a power of 2, then this is precisely the division and mod that gives us the page number and the offset. Right, because how do you do division dealing with powers of 2? How do you do division in a binary number? When you're dividing by a power of 2. So let's say you have a binary number and you're dividing by 2. What's an easy way to do that if you have a binary number? Yeah. Right, you just shift it, right? Because if you take a number, a binary number, and you shift it over 1 bit, you've divided it by 2, right? If you shift it over 2 bits, you've divided it by 4. Right? So remember, the way we got the page number is we're dividing by the page size. So if the page size is a power of 2, which we can ensure that it is, then all we need to do is, you know, to do the division, we're basically just shifting over and we're left with the page number. right? So we're looking in this case, you know, this is 13. And, you know, so again, if we wanted to do this in the sort of more in the non-binary way, to get the page number here, we do 13 divided by the page size, which is 4. So 13 over 4 is what? 3, right? 13 over 4 is 3, the top two bits. And then 13 mod 4 is 1, the last bit. Because essentially when you're doing a mod, then you're essentially just masking out the top bits, and you're left with the bottom set of bits. Right, so the point here is just that the hardware is basically doing that division and that mod, right? Because that's an intuitive way for us to understand it. To get the page number, you do the division. To get the offset, you do the mod. But in hardware, that's potentially a reasonably expensive thing to do. So by making the page size be a power of 2, you don't actually have to do the division or the mod, because you can just look at the top bits and the bottom bits. Make sense to people? Right, because that's all a division by a power of 2 is doing. It's just doing a bit shift. Questions on that? Okay. So we already walked through that example. So now in this example, right, we were saying we want to be able to address every single byte individually. Now that's not typically true, because typically when we're talking about addressing pieces of memory, we're talking about addressing words, right? So like if you have a 32-bit machine, typically you're not, you can't address individual bytes, you're addressing, you know, 4-byte words, 32 bits, right? If you had a 64-bit machine, you'd be addressing 8-byte words. So, you know, in this toy example here, this is essentially if you have like an 8-bit computer. So now let's say if you have a 32-bit computer, you're addressing 4-byte words rather than individual bytes. So in this case, how many bits are we going to need for an address? Right? So the memory size is still 256 bytes. So how many, how many 4-byte words of memory are there that we want to be able to individually address? Right? Because previously we wanted to be able to address every single byte, every single of those 256 bytes. But now if we're saying we're only going to address 4-byte words, then how many words of memory are there? Yeah. Right, exactly. Right, right. Because typically, like your computer, right, like when you're writing an integer, for example, right, it's a 4-byte quantity typically. So like the natural, sort of the natural unit of a 32-bit computer is a 4-byte word, a 32-bit word. So when you're actually, like, if you store, like, a byte in your program, if you, like, allocate a new variable and you make it, you know, a Boolean or something, it's actually typically going to store that in a 32-bit word, even though you're basically not using anything but the low 8 bytes, because your machine can only address the level of words, not the level of individual bytes. Right? So if you have 256 bytes of memory, then how many words do you have if a word is 4 bytes? 64, right? Just 256 bytes divided by 4 bytes in a word is 64 words of memory. So if you have 64 words that you want to be able to address, then now how many bits do you need for an address? 8 bits to address 256 bytes. Now we have 64 words. How many bits do we need to address 64? 6, right? Previously we had 8 bits. Now we only need 6 bits because there are only 64 different unique addresses we want, because we're addressing, you know, 4-byte words in a 256-byte memory space. Right? So now there's only 64 unique addresses. In the previous example, there were 256 unique addresses. Right? So now, again, you know, what part of this is going to be the page number? So, again, we have the same memory size, 256 bytes, and the same page size, 16 bytes. So, how many pages are there? This is the same as the previous example. right? So if we have 256 bytes of memory and a page is 16 bytes, how many pages must there be? Hmm? 16, right? So if you have 16 pages, 16 page entries, then how many bits do you need to encode the page? Four, right? 2 to the 4, 16. And so then how many bits do you need for the offset? Because remember, now we have a 6-bit address, and 4 bits is used to encode the page, so how many bits do we need for the offset? 2, right? We have the 2 remaining bits that encode the offset. Right? And that makes sense because, right, so now the range of the offset is now 0 to 3. But remember, and that's within a 16-byte page. Right, and now we're addressing individual words. So we're addressing a 4-byte word. That's sort of the basic unit. So how many words are in a page now? A 16-byte page is how many words? 4, right? Because if a word is 4 bytes, then a 16-byte page has 4 words. So to offset into a page is going to be 0 to 3. That's why we only need the 2 bits for it. Because we're only addressing each of those, you know, there are 4 potentially words to address within a page. So that's why we have 4 bits for the page, because we still have 16 pages. But then the offset now, previously the offset could be up to 16, because we were addressing individual bytes within the page. We haven't changed the page size here, but we're saying that we can only address an individual word, 4 bytes. So they're only, you know, the offset only is 0 to 3 now, rather than 0 to 15. Make sense? Yeah. Right. So we have the same amount of memory here, 256 bytes, and we are want to address 4-byte words. That's the sort of basic unit of the address. So if we have 256 bytes, then how many words is that? If a word is 4 bytes, 64. Right. 256 divided by 4 is 64 words in the memory space. So we want to be able to address 64 entries, which is 2 to the 6. Whereas previously we wanted to address every single byte, 256 of them, which gives us 2 to the 8. Yeah. Other questions? Okay, so now let's do this example here. So you know, given virtual address 13, do the virtual to physical translation. So again, you know, to get the page number, what are we going to divide by? What do we divide by to get the page number? Page size, right? Mm-hmm. And so the page, and now remember, the virtual addresses now are in terms of bytes. I mean, sorry, in terms of words rather than bytes. Right? So this is referring to a word of memory rather than a byte. So, how many words are there in a page of memory? 4, right? So a page is 16 bytes, which is 4 words. So, to get the page number, we divide 13 by 4, which gives us what? 3, right, because it's an integer division. So the page number is 3. And then the offset is what? You're doing the division to get the page number, and then to get the offset, you're just doing the mod. Right? So 13 mod 4 is just 1. Right? So 13 words here, because that's the virtual address is, you know, in terms of words now, because that's what we can individually address is words. So we're dividing by the number of words in a page, which is 4. Because 4 words is the page size, 16 bytes. So that gives us the page number 3. And then the offset is just doing the mod instead. 13 mod 4 gives us the offset 1. So now we go to, you know, frame 9. And, you know, that's obviously not, you know, that table is not extended its entire length to, you know, 16 entries. But, would go to, so we go to page 3, which is frame 9 in the table. So we go to frame 9, and we offset one word into that, right? Because the addresses are all in terms of words now. So it's one word into frame 9, and that's where the data is. Questions on this? Yeah. Because we have, remember, we want to be able to divide up the whole memory space into pages. So we have 256 bytes of memory. Yeah, and the page size is 16 bytes. That's just what we defined. And so we must have 16 page entries to be able to complete the entire address space. Other questions? Okay. So now let's talk a little bit about how we can actually make paging efficient. So essentially we need to ask, you know, where should we actually store the page table, right? Because efficiency is going to be a major concern here, right? Because whenever you're doing this translation, you have to go through this whole procedure, and every single address you're using is a virtual address. So you're doing this translation over and over and over again as your programs run. So we really need this to be efficient. So, you know, one approach is, let's say we store it in registers, right? Because registers are the absolute fastest thing we have. That's the absolute top of the memory hierarchy is registers. So advantages of that, obviously, that it's as fast as possible. What's the disadvantage of doing it that way? Yeah. You're taking up extra registers. That's true. Maybe you could use those registers for anything else. Other problems? Yeah. Right. Registers are very expensive, and what that basically means is that you have a fixed number and a pretty small fixed number of registers. You know, typically your machine might have maybe a couple of tens of registers, and maybe you have 100, but you certainly are not having, you know, thousands upon thousands of registers. So if you only have a couple of tens of registers to use, then basically the size of your page table is extremely restricted. So that's not good if you want to have, you know, a large, you don't want to be restricted to some small number of pages in your page table. So that's a problem there. So of course then, if we don't want to do that, well, let's say we store it in memory, right? Because memory is essentially as large as we want it to be. We can store the page table in memory and have as much room as we want for it. So, you know, that's going to be the advantage there. What's going to be the downside? Slow, right. It's going to be slow, and remember, we're having to do this every single time we make a memory access, right? So it's going to be awfully bad if every time we need to make a memory access, we have to go do another memory access to do it, right? That's going to be a major efficiency drain. It's basically going to, you know, slow down the process by at least 2x, because every memory access, you're going to incur another memory access just to do the translation. Right, so that's not good. So we essentially want, you know, both the speed of the registers approach with the, you know, size potential of, you know, the lack of size restrictions of storing it in memory. So the way we're going to do this is we're going to use some hardware support called a TLB, a translation book assign buffer. And basically this is going to be like a cache. So this is basically going to be like an L1 cache that is mapping page numbers to the frames that they're stored in. And so, you know, the TLB is going to be much larger than the size of registers, but we don't need, you know, it's going to be much, much faster than memory, but significantly larger than registers. So let's look at how we can do this. So basically what we're going to do now is when we have some page to look up, you know, we want to look up page 5. So we are looking at our virtual address, and it says page 5. So we want to look up in the page table what frame is, you know, which frame is page 5 stored in. So what we're going to do is we're first going to look in the TLB, which is this very fast hardware cache, basically, mapping page numbers to frame numbers. And if it's not in the TLB, if we don't find the page we're looking for in the TLB, then that's what's called a TLB miss, and we're just going to go to the actual page table, which is in memory, so that's going to be pretty slow, and fetch that frame number, and then store the page and frame mapping back into TLB. Right, and so remember, this is another reason why, you know, the TLB is not going to store all of the page tables. It's only going to store some subset of it. But remember, this is going to be really good because, remember, we have the 90-10 rule. Right? So on you expect your program to basically be accessing the same things over and over again most of the time. So what that means is that the vast majority of the time, you're actually going to find what you need in the TLB, which is in hardware, very fast, and you're not actually going to have to go to memory to look it up in the page table. Now, the TLB is actually, you know, that is a hardware feature that is shared among all processes, right? So it's not even just your page table. It's all page tables that are potentially getting thrown into the TLB. But because of the 90-10 rule, you're still going to, you know, get very good performance from the addition of the TLB. Now, of course, you know, like any cache, you basically need to decide, you know, how to, you know, store an evict page entry. So obviously you want data that's, you know, frequently accessed to, you know, you want page numbers that are frequently accessed to stay in the TLB over other pages that are infrequently accessed. So any questions about the basic idea of how the TLB is working? Yeah.
The first time you try to access
typically what you're going to do, and this is not, there are ways to optimize this, but typically what's going to happen is when you start up a process, right, none of its stuff is going to be in the TLB. And you've started it up, and it's going to start requesting things in memory, and those are immediately going to incur page table TLB misses. So it is going to load into the TLB. Now, that's actually one of the reasons we have this valid bit, because remember, this is shared. So, for example, let's say that your OS context switches from some process to some other process. Two processes might have the same page table numbers, right? Like both processes could be accessing page 5, but they could have completely different values in process 1 versus process 2. So essentially, when you switch processes, you're going to set this valid bit to basically say that it's kind of like flushing the TLB out, saying that all of these are no longer valid. Even if you find page 5 in the cache, that's actually still a TLB miss because it might have been a holdover from some previous process you were running. Right? Because the TLB is just, you know, a piece of hardware that's shared by everything. Yeah? Generally, yes. Now, what you can do to optimize that somewhat is that you can basically store the TLB entries in the PCB. And then when you do a context switch, you can basically take the old TLB entries, load them into the hardware TLB, right? Because remember, the PCB is stored in memory. And when you do a context switch, you're dumping all the state into the PCB. So you can dump the TLB entries as well. And then once you are context switching, you can basically just load them back into the TLB, and that will ensure that you aren't going to have the problem you described a minute ago, which is that you're going to have a sort of a completely cold cache, right? If you load it back in when you context switch, then you're still going to have a warm TLB when you start executing again. But of course, in order to do that, you're still, you know, in order to save the TLB, you're incurring some additional context switch cost to both dump the TLB out when you're saving the state and then restore the TLB when you're loading it back in. Other questions? Right, so basically, you know, the TLB here is serving as hardware that is letting us store the page table in memory so that it can be as large as we want it to, but still giving us fast performance by not forcing us to go to memory most of the time. Because most of the time in practice, you're going to find the pages that you need in the TLB. So now let's consider, you know, what is the cost of using the TLB. So you know, let's say that we have, you know, we can ask sort of what is the effective memory access cost, which is basically, you know, how much does it cost to access some location in memory that we want to. You know, if I give you some virtual address and I want to access that address. So if the, you know, if we have some fixed cost to access memory and there is, you know, no TLB and we have the page table in memory, then what is the effective memory access cost as a function of sort of just the hardware cost to go fetch some location in memory? This was the case we talked about a second ago where if the page table is stored in memory and you don't have the TLB, then what do you have to do? Right, right. So basically, it's just, you know, the effective memory access cost, EMA, is basically going to be two times, you know, the actual, you know, two times memory access, MA. Because you have to go to the page table, which is in memory, and then the page table tells you some other place, you know, you grab the frame you need, add the offset, and then that gives you another address that you have to go and make another memory access. Right, so that's sort of the bad case. So now if we're actually using a TLB, then the effective memory access cost is basically going to depend on how often we actually find what we're looking for in the TLB. So, you know, so if we don't find what we're looking for in the TLB, then what is basically the cost going to be? So let's say, for example, that, you know, the let's say that the TLB, you know, we get a TLB hit P percent of the time. Right? So if P is 1, that means we always get a TLB hit. If P is 0, that means we never get a TLB hit. So whenever we get a TLB hit, what is going to be the memory access time? Right, so over here, the effective memory access time without the TLB is 2 times the memory access. Yeah. Right, so basically on a TLB hit, it's just going to be, you know, the memory access and potentially some, you know, little addition owing to actually doing the TLB lookup. Now, the TLB, again, is part of hardware, so this is going to be very, very small, but it is still something to consider there. Right, so this is what you get on a TLB hit. That's the effective memory access cost. And now, on a TLB miss, what is it going to be? Yeah. Go ahead. Right, so, you know, and on a miss, so this is, you know, this is a TLB hit. On a TLB miss, it's going to be, you know, the effective memory access cost is 2 times the memory access. And again, we have plus the TLB, because remember, even though it was a TLB miss, we still did have to do that lookup. Right, so now if we get a TLB hit P percent of the time, then what's sort of the total effective memory access cost of doing memory access is using the TLB. Yeah.
You have to multiply the hit on memory access times P and then the miss times
P. Right. So on a hit, it's this much, and we get a hit P percent of the time, so we multiply that by P. On a miss, it costs this, and if we get a hit P percent of the time, then we get a miss 1 minus P percent of the time, and then we just add those up. Right, so that's what we have here. You know, this is, on a hit, we have memory access plus the cost of the TLB times the TLB hit ratio. And then on a miss, we have 2 times memory access plus TLB times whatever the miss ratio is, which is 1 minus the hit ratio. Right, because the hit ratio plus the miss ratio obviously has to equal 1. So basically, an expression like this tells you how well you're doing based on what your TLB hit ratio is. And so, you know, a high TLB hit ratio is going to decrease the value of this expression, right? And in practice, a TLB hit ratio is typically very, very high, you know, typically well over 90%, for example. So, you know, this in general is going to trend very closely towards just a single memory access, because almost all of the time you're going to be getting a TLB path. Questions on this? Okay. So, just to briefly say, so like how are we actually allocating memory when we're starting a process? This is actually something that was mentioned earlier. So, you know, we have some new process and it needs, you know, k pages of memory. So we're just going to find, you know, k free page frames and then allocate them. Otherwise, we're going to have to, you know, free frames that are no longer needed by some other process. And then we're just going to, you know, populate the page table, right? Because the page table is essentially given to you when you're doing that translation. So the OS has to set up the page table. And then you're going to, you know, flush the TLB, right? That was another thing we mentioned. So we have that extra bit in the TLB, that valid bit. So we can basically just set those all to zero, indicating that, you know, that's always going to be a TLB miss if you try to access that value. Then you can actually start the process, and then while you're running, the values, you know, from the page table are getting loaded into the TLB. And obviously, you know, they're replacing the existing, you know, invalid entries. So, yeah, and I already mentioned, you know, why we need to do the invalid, why we need to invalidate the TLB, because the page numbers are not unique to the process. Right, the page numbers could be used by many different, the same page numbers could be used by many different processes. So in order to handle that case, we need to explicitly invalidate the old entries in the TLB. Questions? Okay. So now this adds, you know, a little bit of overhead to what we need to do on a context switch, because now we've added a few extra things to the PCB that we need to store. Right, so one is the page table. Right, we already said that's being stored in memory. So we need to store the page table in the PCB. And also we mentioned, you know, if you want to have a warm copy of the TLB when you context switch to the process, then you need to be storing it on a context switch and restoring it when you start the process again. So if you want to do that, then you're also storing a copy of the TLB itself in the PCB. So now when you're doing a context switch, you are basically updating the value of this page table base register, which is basically a special hardware register that says where in memory the page table, the active page table begins. Right? So you know, if we have memory and obviously there are page tables, let's just say, you know, this is the, you know, process A page table is just in this region of memory. And the process B page table is in this region of memory. So there's going to be some page table register that is going to, when process A is executing, it's just going to point to this. So when we do a page table lookup, all we're basically doing is indexing off this address to look up something in the page table for A. And when we context switch to B, we're going to change this so that this is now pointing to the page table for B. So whenever we are doing a memory lookup, we hit a TLB miss, we have to go to the page table, we follow this register to the page table for B in memory and just offset into that. Right, so this is just, you know, telling us the position in memory that we can offset into to get the, to do page table lookups in the current process. Right, so on a context switch, we're updating that value, we're copying the TLB, you know, optionally if we are storing that in the PCB. You know, flushing the PCB, and then once we're, you know, done, we're restoring the page table-based register and storing the TLB. Questions? Right. So, one other thing that paging is doing for us that's very nice is that it lets us share memory pretty easily, right? Because in the previous example with when we were talking about relocation, and a process has, you know, a contiguous block of memory to use, right, that block is just for that one process. And there's no way that a process can access memory in another process, even if you might want it to. But with paging, we can actually do that pretty easily. Because all we need to do is basically update two page tables to point to the same frame of memory. Right, so if you have two page tables, then those are each pointing to a specific frame in memory. And you can very easily take two page tables and have two different, you know, pages, which are, you know, to their corresponding processes, and have those refer to the same frame of physical memory. So that's very useful when you want to do something like load a shared library, right? So a lot of processes running on your machine might be using, you know, the C standard library or the Java library or whatnot. You don't want to have to load that library into your process every single time the process wants to use it. You don't want to have to repeatedly load the library. So instead, what you can basically do is you're going to have a copy of that shared library sitting in memory somewhere. And when you want to load the library, all you basically do is you update the, you know, the relevant pages of your page table to point to the single location of the shared library. And now, of course, when you're doing this, you need to ensure that, you know, processes are not going to, you know, basically change the shared piece that you're sharing between processes. But, you know, in the case of something like a shared library, you're basically just reading, you know, routines from that. You're not actually, you know, writing to that piece of data. So, yeah, so to, you know, summarize what we talked about with paging, you know, big improvement over relocation, the major thing we're addressing is the problem of external fragmentation, where, you know, with external fragmentation, we basically are forced to run frequent compaction, which can be really expensive. So with paging, there is no external fragmentation because everything is in fixed size frames that can be, you know, scattered anywhere. And then, you know, it also lets us very easily share code pages, you know, things like shared libraries, which is also going to reduce the actual physical memory requirements, right? Because if you have 10 different processes all accessing the same shared library, if you have to load them each time into the process's own memory, then you're going to have 10 copies. Versus if you just update the page table, you can still just have one copy and have every page table point to that one copy. And we're going to talk more about this third benefit next time, but basically we're going to be able to run processes only partially loaded into main memory. But we'll defer discussion of that till next time. But, you know, paging, like just about anything else, we're getting these nice new features, but they do come with a cost, right? They're almost always trade-offs. And so, you know, what are the trade-offs here? Well, the trade-offs are we're complicating that translation, right? Because the virtual address to physical address is more time-consuming because we introduced the idea of a page table, right? And in order to make that efficient, we have to add some additional hardware. So we have to, you know, we added the TLB to allow paging to be efficient, so we're imposing some additional hardware requirements. And then, of course, the OS itself has to do some additional maintenance in order to keep track of page tables while your processes are running. Right? So paging is, you know, the benefits are really nice, but still some costs, you know, largely in terms of efficiency and complexity. Any questions on paging before we move on? So now let's switch gears a little bit and talk about segmentation. So basically so far we've talked about memory management. So we've talked about memory sort of as if it's just a linear series of bytes, right? Like it's just a big massive array, and that's what memory is. And so we have, you know, pieces of, you know, we have pages of linear bytes mapped onto frames. But, you know, from the perspective of memory management, there's sort of no conception of, like, what a process is, right? Because memory is just a bunch of frames with a bunch of pages mapped onto those frames, and that's it. But something like the compiler or the programmer typically has a very different view of how memory is organized, right? So if we sort of sketch out... Right, so if we consider sort of what a, you know, what a process looks like in terms of memory, it's basically a series of segments, right? So we have things like, you know, the text segment is going to be down here. You know, we're going to have, you know, the heap is going to be somewhere here. You know, and that grows up. We're going to have, you know, stack somewhere here. Right, so when the compiler is generating things, the compiler is not actually outputting addresses from zero to whatever. It's actually saying, you know, local variable is this offset from the stack, you know, this offset into the heap. So we're actually considering things, you know, the compiler view that's sort of more intuitive is basically a program is a series of segments, you know, which are, you know, like the stack segment, the heap segment, the program code segment, rather than just sort of a linear series of bytes. So segmentation is basically going to be a memory management scheme that maps more onto this view, where we're going to have, you know, sort of logical pieces of memory corresponding to, you know, things like the stack, the heap, and text. So, you know, as I mentioned, like to give another example, when a compiler is, you know, when you like write a for loop and a compiler is telling your program where to jump, it's again not outputting sort of an absolute address within the process, because that's sort of a vague notion. What it's actually doing is it's outputting some offset within the code segment saying, you know, where the line of code is that your program will jump to. So, you know, the compiler is not outputting absolute, you know, virtual addresses. It's instead referencing these segments. So that's the idea in segmentation. So the idea here is it's going to be a little bit similar to paging. So we have a number of these segments. So in this example, maybe we have three. We might have several others, but, you know, we call these the three main segments, maybe. And so each segment is going to have some segment number, and we're basically going to reference specific segments and offsets into that segment. So we're basically going to have a bunch of base and limit registers referencing each one of those segments. So, you know, a virtual address now is going to have some segment number that's going to index into a segment table. And, you know, in the table, that's going to tell us what position in memory the segment starts and how long the segment goes. Right? So now this is, again, this is a contiguous block of memory. Right? So like the program code here is going to be some fixed piece of memory. The heap is going to be some contiguous piece of memory, you know, so on and so forth. So when you're actually doing this, you take the segment number, look up the base and limit to actually check the offset into that segment, and then just add the base, and assuming you are within grounds, just add the segment offset and the segment base to get the physical address, which will be in one of these segments. Right? And that's basically really nice for the compiler, because that's essentially how the compiler is actually outputting addresses. So, so we're actually going to, we again need to answer the question, you know, where are we going to store the segment table? Now, this is going to be a little bit different than in paging, because remember we said, how many pages could there potentially be? Yeah. Right, there could be a potentially huge number of pages, right, because pages are very small and you can lose a lot of memory. But how many segments are we typically going to expect there to be? Right, like typically, you're only going to have a very small number of segments, right? Because segments are sort of logical pieces of the process. And you're never going to have a case where you have 10,000 different logical pieces of a process, right? Each one of these pieces, each one of the segments may be of arbitrary size, but there's only going to be a few number of the segments. So we can actually do this using actual registers to do this segment table. Remember, we couldn't really do that in the paging case because we could have a huge number of pages. But because we only have a small number of segments, we can actually use hardware, you know, base and limit registers to do this, to keep track of each one of the segments. Now, what is sort of, we sort of regressed in one sense considering these segments, and why, what is the problem here that we didn't have with paging that we are going to have if we're using segments again? Right. We've sort of reintroduced the problem of fragmentation, right? Because we've said again that the segments are going to be contiguous, and they could be any arbitrary size, so we've again going to have to deal with, you know, fragmentation again, you know, as we were dealing with when we were talking about relocation. So, you know, again, this is essentially all what we already said. You know, compiler is generating virtual addresses, and the virtual addresses are now giving you a segment number and an offset. And then we're, you know, giving each segment a continuous piece of physical memory, but we are reintroducing the problem of fragmentation. So you can essentially do it, you know, similar to paging. If you have a ton of segments, you might need something like the TLB, but in practice, you are not going to have very many segments. So you, in practice, can do this using registers. So, you know, this is very nice for the compiler. Paging is very nice for the OS because it's eliminating the problem of your fragmentation and everything. So essentially what we really want to do is we want to combine the benefits of segments with the, you know, efficient memory utilization we get when we're using pages. You know, no fragmentation and the like. So anyone have any idea of how we might do that? So how is this different from the standard, the earlier, very simple relocation approach in terms of how we're allocating memory? Right, so in the relocation approach, remember we just said, here's a process, we're just gonna give it some block of memory. And when we wanted to deal with fragmentation there, what we said was, okay, let's page the processes. So now, right, this is kind of a similar idea. We've now got, again, blocks of memory. We just have multiple blocks corresponding to different segments. But so if we want to get rid of external fragmentation, what can we actually do with the individual segments? Yeah. Right. We can take these individual segments and we can page them, just as we previously did on the entire process block. So the idea is we want to do paging within the segments. So, you know, we're going to treat the virtual address space as a collection of, you know, logical segments, but then we're still going to take physical memory and divide it up into, you know, fixed page frames, you know, fixed page frames. And so, you know, a segment, again, can be an arbitrary size, right? So segments can be very, very large. You could have, you know, a heap with a lot of data in it. And so those are typically going to be the size of many pages. So what we're going to do is we're going to take each segment and page the segments to map them onto physical page frames. So basically, this is going to look something like this, where now, you know, in the virtual address space, it's no longer just an array of bytes, right? This is how the compiler is basically looking at things, where we have a collection of logical segments and offsets into those segments that the compiler is generating. And on the, you know, that's the virtual address space. And in physical memory, we are taking each one of these segments and paging it. Right, and so each one of these is corresponded with multiple pages potentially, and those are all mapped onto physical memory, just as we did before. So, again, here now we don't need contiguous allocation in memory. You know, it's still logically contiguous from the perspective of the compiler, but it's not actually contiguous in physical memory. Right, so what we're basically trying to do here is we're trying to combine, you know, the OS view of memory, which is just a linear array of bytes, that's the sort of the physical view, with the compiler view, which is all of these logical segments. Now, of course, in order to do this, again, we have trade-offs here. Trade-off here is, again, that we are, again, adding some more complexity for how we want to do address translation. So now, basically, we have the page number and the offset, and now we're adding on a segment number. Right, so now we have a virtual address. It doesn't have two components. Remember, in pure paging, we just had a page number and an offset. Now we have three components. We have the offset into the page, the page number, and then the segment number. And now we have two tables. We have the segment table and the page table. Right, so if I have a virtual address, it's going, you know, the top couple of bits are going to give you the segment number. So you go to the specific, you know, if I go to segment 3, that's going to tell me, now it's not going to tell you where exactly in memory the segment starts. It's going to tell you where the page table for that segment is. So now every single individual segment has its own page table, right? Because that's what we said we were going to do. We have multiple segments, and we're going to page each segment individually. Right, so we have a segment table with we have one entry for each segment, and what the segment table directs us to is the page table for that segment. So if, you know, my virtual address says segment 3, then that's going to give me the base address of the page table for segment 3. Now I have the page table I want, and I just do the regular paging thing. I have a page number and an offset. I look at the page number, index into the page table, and then offset into that frame. Right, so standard paging idea that we're just combining with the idea of segmentation by having a segment table, and the segment table points to multiple page tables. So the bits of the address that tells us which segment we want also then gives us the actual page table we're indexing into for that specific segment. So how many, so each process now has one segment table. Remember, and this can be stored in registers because this is small. One segment table and a variable number of page tables depending on the number of segments. The page tables, of course, are still going to be stored in memory. So, you know, but remember, a key thing to remember here is that all of this is still happening in hardware, right? So, like, the OS is, of course, having to manage page tables and so forth, but this actual translation, basically everything pictured here, is still going on in hardware. So it's still going to be very, very fast. So we already talked a little bit about this, but, you know, we have to answer the question, where are the segment tables and page table stores? You know, the segment tables, as I said, are basically, you can use a small number of associated registers. Page tables are, of course, still going to be in main memory. You're still going to use a TLB to, you know, make paging fast. Now, you could also, you know, take the segment table and stick that in main memory, combine it with the TLB. Now, if you were to do that, then your TLB now would have not just a page number and a frame number, but a segment number, page number, and it would basically associate a segment page pair to a frame number. But again, in practice, usually you're just storing the segment table in some registers. So let's look at an example of this. So let's again say that we have, you know, 256 addressable words, and for the moment let's just assume that a word is a single byte. You know, a page table indexing, you know, 8 different pages, page size of 32 words, and let's say 8 logical segments, right? The 8 is sort of arbitrary. So how many bits are going to be in a physical address? Right, so how many memory locations do we have to address here? Right, without regard to what the page, you know, what the memory management system is, we have 256 bytes or words, whichever you want to use, because we're saying a byte is a word here. And so how many bits do we need to have 256 addressable words? Yeah. Right. So again, 2 to the 8. So you need 8 bits to be able to address 256 addresses. And now, how many bits is in a virtual address? So remember, previously, a virtual address is the same length as a physical address. Now that's actually not going to be the case because we're adding this segment, the segment part off the end. So if we have 8 logical segments, how many bits do we need to represent the segment number? So if we have 8 segments, then how many bits do we need? 4? So 2 to the 4th is 16, right? So 3. Yeah. Yeah, so we have 8 segments, so we need 3 bits to address those 8 segments. Now how many bits do we need for the page number? Right, so we said already said we have, you know, 8 entries in the page table, so how many bits do we need for pages? 3, right? So 3 bits for the segment, 3 bits for the page, and then how many bits do we need for the offset? If the, you know, page size is 32 words, so how many bits do we need? Well, so we have 32 words in the page. So, right, so we need 5 bits for that, like 2 to the 5th. So we're going to have three segment bits, three page bits, and five offset bits. So how long is the virtual address going to be? Right. So the virtual address is actually going to be longer than the physical address now. And the reason that is because we're adding these three segment bits. Right? Because essentially, all those segment bits are doing is those segment bits are telling us where to find the page table. Right? So the virtual address now length is sort of arbitrary depending on the number of segments we want to be able to index. Right? Because previously, virtual address, same length as physical address, but now we need to be able to address however many segments we have. And then once we have the segment, then we have the regular, you know, in this case, the regular 8 bits to cover the address space. Right? So the segment number has nothing to do with physical memory. That's essentially just supporting the compiler view of these various segments. Does that make sense to people? Right? The segment number has nothing to do with the arrangement in physical memory. It's just letting us look up the page tables to support these logical independent segments. Questions on that before I move on? Now, just as in paging, we can basically use the exact same idea to share segments, right? So in paging, what we did was we took entries in the page table and just mapped them to the same frame to share pages. We can do the exact same thing with sharing segments, because we have the segment table. So now, when we want to have segments that point to the same thing, remember, segments are pointing to page table entries in memory, or rather, the segment table points you to the beginning of the page table for that segment. So now we can update segment tables in multiple processes to point to the same page table. And that essentially, just by updating that one value, we have shared the entire segment, right? Because any virtual address that points to that segment is going to go into that page table. So that actually makes it very easy to load things like a shared library, which are typically going to be loaded as a segment, right? So all you have to do is update that one value to point to the segment for that shared library, and you're all set. You don't need to load the whole thing again. Now, of course, you can also do the page level sharing in exactly the same way as we did before. You can go into your page tables and update those values to share specific frames of memory. So you have the flexibility to both share segments and share pages. Right, so let's just review sort of what are the costs and benefits here. So, you know, the main benefit is that we're basically merging the compiler view with the OS view of memory. And we're still getting, you know, flexible process growth. Because of paging, there's no external fragmentation, and we're getting very easy memory sharing between processes. But of course, the trade-off here is that, you know, we're getting slower context switches and, you know, slower address translation. So, and also I just should mention, so remember, we are still getting no external fragmentation, but we're still getting internal fragmentation. So remember, internal fragmentation is like the leftovers within either a page or a segment. So does anyone recall from last class how much internal fragmentation you expect to have in pure paging? So remember, if you have some process, and remember, a process can be arbitrary length. Let's say this is the memory in the process, and we're splitting this up into pages. These pages are all fixed size. So what's the internal fragmentation? Right, so the process can be an arbitrary length. So it's not bound to be the same length, you know, it doesn't need to be a multiple of pages. Yeah. Right, but there is going to be external fragmentation for this last page. Right, because even if this is the only bit of the memory that the process actually needs, we need to allocate in terms of page sizes. So we're just going to give it this complete page, and this part is basically wasted. Right, so that's internal fragmentation. So, in the pure paging case, on average, how much do we expect to be wasted per process? Yeah. less than 4K to 4K, but more specifically, on average, you expect to waste how much of the one page on the end? Just on average. Well, less than one, but specifically one half, right? Because you could waste, you know, one bit of this, or you could waste the whole thing, but just on average, you're going to expect to lose basically one half of the last page to an internal fragmentation. Right, just because you know, the actual amount in any given process is basically random. So on average, you're losing half of the last page. Right, so the internal fragmentation in pure paging is expected to be half a page per process, right? So how much internal fragmentation do we expect when we're doing segmented paging? Yeah. Right, because now remember, in pure paging, this is a process. Now in segmented paging, this is a segment. And there's a separate segment that's being paged for every single segment we're using. Right? So now, every single segment, we're losing, on average, half a page to internal fragmentation. So now if we have three segments, on average, we expect to lose 1.5 pages to internal fragmentation. Right? So we're essentially scaling up the internal fragmentation by the number of segments we have. People see how that works, right? Because we're doing the regular paging thing on each one of the segments individually. So on average, whenever we're doing this paging, we expect to lose half of the last page, just on average. Because we could lose any amount of it, so on average, it'll be one half. Okay, now just very briefly, I want to talk about one last thing, which is how to deal with very large address spaces. So suppose you have a 64-bit machine. Well, a 64-bit machine has 64-bit addresses. Those are massive, right? Like a 64-bit machine can hold terabytes of RAM. Not disk space, but terabytes of actual RAM. So what's sort of the problem there with what we're talking about? What's sort of the problem with doing paging and the like? Yeah. Right, the page table could be absolutely massive. Like the overhead of storing the page table could be significant even when you're just storing it in RAM. Yeah. Well, you could use the same process to do memory translation, but it's essentially the fact that the page tables are huge. And because you have page tables for, you know, every single process, sorry, do you have something else? Yes, well, that's actually a good point. Yes, the larger pages you have, the more loss to internal fragmentation you're going to get. So in general, small pages are not. I mean, you want to strike a balance between having small enough pages to efficiently use memory, but large enough pages that you don't have a ton of internal fragmentation. So basically, with a huge address space, page tables are very big, and in practice, you aren't actually going to use much of your address space, right? Because if you can address, you know, 10 terabytes of memory, the odds of you actually using anything approaching that is very, very low. So typically you have what's called a sparse page table, which is where you're only using a very small amount of it. So what we can do here to deal with that is use what's called an inverted page table. And the idea here is that rather than storing that page table basically as an array, right, because it's basically, previously we basically looked at it as it's a lookup array, right, where you just go to the specific page number and that gives you the frame. So instead, we can basically use a hash table where we can do a key value lookup on the page number. So there it's not potentially stored as an array, so we don't have to incur the entire cost of it. Now, of course, doing that is going to make the process of doing a hash lookup, a hash table lookup is obviously much slower than a direct array lookup. So in order to deal with that, of course, we're still using TLDs for efficiency. And one other approach to doing this, which I won't go into too much detail on, is to use what we call multi-level page tables. So the idea here is that previously, when we talked about page tables, we had one page table, and it would cover the entire length of memory. But what we can do instead is make this a multi-level table, where, in this case, this is a two-level table. Each one of these entries in the initial page table actually points to another page table. Right, so this is like a hierarchical page table where each one of these entries, this is basically partitioning the address space. So, you know, maybe this is only, say, 64 entries. So you partition the huge address space into 64 pieces, and then each one of those 64 pieces has its own page table. And so in doing that, you can still access all of memory, but you don't actually need to allocate all of these page tables unless you actually need them. And you could even do this at multiple levels. You could have a three-level page table where these second-level page tables index into a third level of page tables. Basically, just split your address space as much as you want. And so in doing so, you can still cover the whole address space without actually using a ton of space to store the page tables. Because you can basically just, you know, ignore the parts of the address space that you're not using. And in a huge address space, most of it you're not going to be using. Make sense? So just lastly, just recap the big terms here. So we started with relocation, you know, base and limit registers, really simple, but, you know, really inflexible. You know, segmentation is when we're talking about, you know, the compiler's view of memory, which is, you know, logical segments corresponding to pieces of a process. You know, paging is basically the OS's view of memory, which is just a very long array of bytes. So we can, you know, use paging to actually deal with, you know, address external fragmentation rather. And then we can basically combine segmentation and paging to get the main benefits of both of them. And that will come at, you know, some added complexity, but we can get, you know, the main benefits of both that we want. So far we've essentially only assumed that the whole process is stored in RAM when it's running. So next class we're going to basically relax that assumption and talk about the case when you actually don't need all of the processes' pages to be in memory for it to run. So that's called demand page virtual memory, and that's what we'll talk about next time.